as we were just discussing in the last block, the alleged murder of 16-year-old Aksa Parviz this past week raised some questions about the role religion might have played in the tragedy. But for an Oxford professor named Richard Dawkins, there's no questions at all. His goal, you see, is nothing less lofty than to rid the world of religion entirely.
The time has come for people of reason to say enough is enough. Religious faith discourages independent thought, it's divisive, and it's dangerous.
To some, he's the intellectual champion of science, the defender of Darwin. To others, especially at this time of year, Richard Dawkins is the Grinch who's trying to steal Christmas, and any other religious holiday for that matter. His book, The God Delusion, is a worldwide bestseller and was made into a BBC documentary. In the wake of the publicity, the atheist movement realized it's found its champion. And soon, others joined his anti-religious crusade. And this past week, the number one film in North America is The Golden Compass, an openly anti-religious movie based on Philip Pullman's fantasy book for children, a book that some Catholic school boards across Canada have pulled from their shelves. We decided to sit down with Richard Dawkins to do what many families, regardless of their faith, will do over the coming holiday. Get into a good old-fashioned debate. We are in the midst of what some call an atheist movement. Christopher Hitchens, and there's several books, yours perhaps being the leading book. Many of them are why religion has not served people well. It has been a force for negativity in the world. What's your view on that?
I don't want to say it's been a holy force for negativity. I think that it's been, many individuals have been motivated powerfully to do good by their religion. Many individuals have been powerfully motivated to do evil by their religion. So I don't want to get into the position of totting up the good deeds and the evil deeds that are done by religion. I think it is irrational to allow your life to be governed by faith which is based upon something other than evidence. It may be that you do good because you have a faith based on something other than evidence, but it's still irrational to do so.
Those people who would say, Dawkins, I believe in Jesus or whatever God they decide, and I felt the presence of the Lord. I have had that personal experience in a way that whatever you say with fancy Darwin talk, I have felt it the way I felt this chair.
Yeah.
How do you respond to that?
Well, I mean, I'm not impressed by that because there are a similar number of people who are who brought up Hindus and say, I felt the presence of Lord Krishna and etc. I mean, there are all sorts of illusions that the human brain is very capable of creating.
And that's an illusion. Those people deluded, those people that say they have had a religious experience?
I think they are, yes.
Those people who say that we have experienced a miracle, that God has interceded in the world.
So. Yes, most definitely.
That's a delusion.
Yes.
Was Jesus, in your mind, a deluded figure?
No, I doubt it. I mean, we know so little about him because you can't rely upon the Gospels. I suspect that Jesus, in his own time, was a great teacher, a great moralist. His moral values were way ahead of his time. I think he was an admirable. I mean, that's why I wrote an article called Atheists for Jesus, and somebody gave me a T-shirt with Atheists for Jesus written on it.
But the notion that raising Lazarus from the dead.
Oh, of course. I mean, that kind of story happens so easily. It happens to this day. There are all sorts of people reporting miracles all the time, and we don't. You don't believe them because it just doesn't happen to chime in with the religion in which you were brought up.
Many people have criticized you, and when they read The God Delusion, you, for example, you talk about the Jewish God, and you say genocidal, homophobic, racist, you use very provocative terms.
Well, that's the Abrahamic God, which is the God of the Jews, Christians, and Muslims, yes.
Yeah, you are absolutely provocative on your descriptions.
Read Leviticus, read Deuteronomy. I don't need to do any more than just quote.
But is that a caricature to take the worst or the most fundamentalist, literalist readings of it as opposed to the thousands of years of evolution of all of those religions?
Two things to say about that. One is that there are many people in this world who do take the Bible or the Quran literally, and literally do think that you should stone homosexuals to death or whatever it might be. That's the first thing to say. The second thing to say is that even those people who don't say that, those people who have, as you say, evolved, have moved on. They have moved on for secular reasons. We've now abolished slavery. We now give equal rights to women. We now give votes to women. That's nothing to do with scripture. That's nothing to do with the Bible. That's come about in spite of the Bible. And people have now gone back to the Bible and said, oh, well, we'll leave out that bit. We'll leave out that bit.
Although some would say, the abolishment of slavery was very much inspired by the Bible, even though slavery might have been the same.
Well, you've got to be joking, because what you're saying is that you can, if you look through the Bible, pick a verse. You can probably find a verse that you can read as abolishing slavery, and then you've got another verse that says you should keep slaves. So you're picking and choosing. That's all I'm saying. We don't get our morals from the Bible, because we pick and choose on the basis of a modern morality which has evolved. You're quite right to say it's evolved. It's evolved for secular reasons, and now with hindsight, having evolved our morality for secular reasons, we can go back to the Bible and we can, as it were, rub out the bits that don't fit with our modern secular morality. Just don't read them anymore, and that's what people do.
World would be better in your mind without religion?
Yes, I think it probably would. I mean, I think it is certainly true that there have been some good things, like Martin Luther King was probably inspired by religion, for example.
Not probably, he was.
Well, okay, I mean, he was just as much inspired by Gandhi, who was of a very different religion, if any at all. So I think that it would probably be better to say that the movements like the movement for feminism, the movement for black emancipation, the movement to abolish slavery, the movement to abolish cruelty to animals and things, these have all been mainly secular, cultural, evolutionary events, and church people have been prominent in some of them, as it happens.
If religion and belief in God has not been helpful, as you say, it's deluded people. Atheism doesn't exactly have a stellar record. I mean, societies that have tried to live without religion and God.
You're not going to bring out Hitler and Stalin again, are you?
You brought out fundamentalism for religion. Why is it not fair to try to use examples of societies that have tried to live without religion?
Are you seriously bringing up Hitler and Stalin?
How do you argue that the bloodiest century that we've just lived through, 20th century, was bloody, and it also happened to be the one that declared war against religion to a certain degree?
This is so easy. Hitler and Stalin happened to, well, Stalin was an atheist, Hitler wasn't, but it doesn't matter that Hitler was Catholic and Stalin was an atheist. They were deeply evil men. They were motivated by quasi-religions of their own, in Hitler's case, invention, in Stalin's case, inheritance. These men were deeply evil. They were motivated by deeply evil quasi-religions, cultural religion substitutes. It was purely incidental. It's as incidental if they were atheists as Hitler wasn't.
Well, could we say the same thing about the 9/11 hijackers? It was incidental that they were religion?
No, indeed you could not. It was not incidental, because it was religion that motivated them all the way. It was religion that gave them the courage to do it. It was religion. I mean, you know perfectly well what the last words of those hijackers were.
Right, but Stalin, you could say the same thing about Stalin and his war against
atheism. He was motivated by Marxism. He was motivated by a deluded vision of a paradisical future.
Richard Dawkins is confident that Darwin's theory of evolution explains everything, making God irrelevant. But how does he answer some of the more philosophical questions that can't be measured in a lab?
Science tells us that when we love our children, in fact, what's happening is in your brain there is some serotonin uptake or some dopamine, some chemical fusion that happens that makes us feel love. However you may explain that, the love of your children goes beyond that chemical formula into something beyond science. It's a window into something ineffable.
I fully accept that science cannot actually explain love. I can't say love is the uptake of this, that, or the other chemical, love is this, that, or the other neurons. But it is entirely believable that although we cannot explain it, we cannot explain the details, nevertheless, there is nothing beyond that. But you've done nothing by calling it ineffable and transcendent. You're just using words. You're not getting anywhere by doing that. I'm not getting anywhere either, but I'm admitting it.
If we are simply evolved apes, right.
Which we are.
And our behavior is determined by this natural selection. How do we explain those people who do good things for others, for total strangers, the charitable urge, the philanthropic urge? What Darwinian impulse would explain doing good for a total stranger?
Well, that's a very interesting question, and I do devote a chapter or two to it. It's not that difficult for Darwinism to explain doing good, not to total strangers, but to particular people, particular individuals, such as close relatives and other individuals whom you're likely to meet again and again throughout life, and therefore are in a position to reciprocate that good deed.
In other words, it helps your family,
that's
and there's
right.
some self-benefit,
that's
self-interest.
Right. And that's common throughout the animal kingdom and is well understood. The difficulty comes in explaining, as you say, why we're good to total strangers. I think probably the right Darwinian explanation is to say it's a sort of misfiring. A very crude misfiring would be the misfiring towards a cuckoo, being good to a cuckoo by its foster parent. The foster parent is totally unrelated to the cuckoo, but it doesn't know that, so to speak. Natural selection has built into the cuckoo foster parent, reed warbler, whatever it is, a mechanism which says, be nice to small squawking things in your nest, and that works. Don't shake your head, it's entirely plausible.
I know,
that is what happens.
But when you say a misfiring,
yes.
So I am nice to a homeless person on the street, and you're suggesting that it's a misfiring of my Darwinian
yes.
impulse.
Yes, but that's not to demean it in any way, because what I'm trying to explain is that there definitely is a desire to be good, a desire to be nice, a feeling of empathy, a feeling of sympathy. When I see an unfortunate person, somebody who is destitute, I want to help them. I really do. I mean, it's a strong desire. It's as strong as a sexual lust, and I think the sexual lust is actually not a bad analogy. Now, in our history, the lust to be good once worked in Darwinian terms, because everybody you met in those days would be likely to be either a close relative or somebody that you were going to meet again who would therefore be able to reciprocate it. That's why the lust to be good was built in. Now, we live in big cities, the people we meet are total strangers. It's as though we're on the pill. It's as though we are no longer
horny
in a position
to do good.
Sorry?
We're just instinctively horny to do good works?
If you're demeaning it by using that phrase.
Well,
I'm trying to explain to you by using an analogy of sex. The
but
analogy
are you
works.
Are you demeaning the charitable impulse, which some would say lies at the heart of religion and the morality? Are you demeaning that kind of morality by saying it's a misfiring of a Darwinian impulse, as
I'm
opposed
not demean,
to
I'm
actually
trying to explain
something
it. I'm trying to enlighten by explaining, and I'm using sex as an analogy. And you have got to admit that we feel sexual lust, even though we're using contraception, and therefore, from a Darwinian point of view, the sexual lust is not working anymore. We still feel the lust. Now, I'm saying that the parallel to that is that in our Darwinian history, we felt a lust to be good in just the same way as we felt a lust to be sexy.
Could one argue that, to use that analogy, if you're beholden to the Darwinian theory, it shows not a consistency of the Darwinian theory, but a failure, a paucity of the Darwinian theory, and its
yes.
inability to explain
yes.
good charitable
not
works?
Not an inability to explain, but an inability to discriminate between situations in which the Darwinian impulse is, in a Darwinian sense, appropriate and when it isn't appropriate.
Would that suggest that in the future we will evolve away from the Darwinian impulse
possibly,
to do good?
Possibly. But the force of that question is exactly the same as the force of does it suggest that we will completely lose our sexual lust if in the future we go through generations of using contraception? I don't think actually that either of those will happen.
It's a great pleasure to speak
yes.
with you always.
Thank you very much.
Thanks so much.
Okay.
There's few people who are as fun to debate as Richard Dawkins. But what do you think about the debate between atheists and people of faith? Are atheists becoming more fundamentalist than some religious people? Can belief in God coexist with a belief in science? Many scientists believe that. We'd like to hear, and many theologians believe that. We'd like to hear your thoughts on all the stories we bring you, the story we brought you about the veil. Here's how to reach us. You can write to us at CBC News Sunday, Box 500, Station 8, Toronto, Ontario, M5W1E6. Our email address is Sunday at CBC.ca, or visit us online anytime at cbc.ca/Sunday. You can also view our stories, post our comments. That's the kind of debate we usually have, Carol.
It's like, what about the Darwinian impulse to slap somebody upside the head?
That's what he is with everybody.